And Steve said it very casually, as if he'd just seen it in a movie that hadn't interested him that much, but I was lying on a couch, and I just stood up, and, you know, it was almost like the day had gone dark, and I started asking him questions about it, you know, how, what had happened, and he answered somewhat, but he didn't want to talk about it for that long. But we got together over the summer, because he's a very good illustrator, and I hired him to do some drawings for me. And his drawing was great, but as the summer of 2002 progressed, he was falling apart. He was he had a small, dark apartment, which I never saw, he told me, and he was not leaving very often unless he was drinking. He was reading and drinking and just being very depressed and looking for a job. And he was very distracted. And I remembered a man on my street had been in a concentration camp as a kid, and he told me that September 11th had triggered the trauma of that all over again. And from Steve's symptoms, I wondered if maybe the child psychiatrist had affected him. So in our business meetings, at the end of each meeting, I would ask him, get more and more details about Dr. Ayres, whose name I didn't know. I just said, what did the doctor do? And, you know, he gave me presents. And I don't know about here, but in New York City, in the New York Times, it seemed that every day there were stories about the priests in Boston, and I had read them, and I knew that they were always booing the children with presents. So I heard, oh, a chess set, he bought that for you? That just seems not right. And the more I heard, the more upset I got. But I was afraid to do anything because I just kept pulling details. And I'd known Steve about 2 months, and he seemed to be getting worse, more distracted. And finally, I said, we are in Barnes & Noble at a business meeting. And he had some nightmares, and I said, was it about the psychiatrist? And he said, yes, and he looked very stricken. And he had that look where an adult man faces a 12-year-old who'd been molested. It was like a head-on collision. And I'd seen that look many times, and I couldn't stand it anymore. So I said, what's the doctor's name? And he said, this was 2 months I'd known him, right? And I was afraid to ask, because I knew once I got the name, I was really going to have to do something. He said, Dr. William Ayres, A-Y-E-R-S. So he spelt his name wrong. And before all this, leading up to it, I asked all my friends and acquaintances, should I do something about this guy? This is really, you know, this doctor. Everybody said yes, you know, like, come on, you're going to do it. There was a guy at my local Barnes & Noble who was sort of a hippie who actually grew up in Los Angeles. His name was Damien. And every time I saw him, he'd say, have you done anything about that doctor? You were put here to do something about it. No, I haven't. It's a huge responsibility. I didn't quite know what I was going to do. All that summer, I urged Steve to ask his parents whether the doctor was still alive or to go to the police. He would do neither, which is very typical. So once I got the doctor's name, I asked my own psychiatrist. I said, can you just ask around with your colleagues? Of course, he didn't want to do that. Like, that would not be, that would be breaking confidentiality. And then he said, with your investigative skills, if you want to nail him, you can. And I thought, great. But I was mad at him. I wanted him to, you know, ask all, I thought he was sitting on a gold mine of connections, but he wouldn't do it for me, which is the right thing to do. And Steve had told me if I found other victims, he would talk to the police. But he was sure he was the only victim. He was absolutely certain. I said, no. And I actually I used to work for People magazine, and I interviewed a cop in 1991 who was very tenacious, and I stayed in touch with him. And I called him up for advice, and he said, you tell your friend Steve he's not the only victim. I've dealt with so many pedophiles, they keep doing it until they're 80. So I told that to Steve, and he still wouldn't, you know, he said, but if you can find other victims, I'll go to the police. Like, oh, great. So I'm thinking, the easiest way to find out is to go to the San Mateo Police Department, but I was terrified because I've been a victim of a crime myself in New York, but I'd never called the police as a whistleblower on behalf of somebody else. So to buy time, this all, I found, I skipped a part. I found it wasn't easy to find Dr. Ayres. I know how to find people really well, but when you're, as a journalist, you're sort of intrepid and you've got an editor waiting for you, but I was a citizen looking for this doctor. I didn't know if he was dead or alive or in jail or skipped town, and I asked a couple of friends who were doctors, and it was just, I felt that I was looking for someone who's never really existed, who was in a, and I was walking through a fog, and I was very insecure, and the act of looking for him brought up my own issues about being molested too, so I felt not very safe. There was, you know, my friends said, come on, go look for him, but I was the one who was actually having to go to the library. So I went to the New York Public Library, and I wasn't very secure about it, and I remember there was a homeless guy there, and he's been working, he's been in my library for about 15 years, and he's always working on the same manifesto, you know, with something about Satan, and but he thinks it's really important, right? And I thought, oh, I'm going to end up like this homeless guy, you know, looking for heirs, it's going to be like him, like looking for this project, and you know, this homeless guy used to try to sell his work on the street in front of Barnes & Noble, and there are never any takers, and but he thinks it's important. I thought, well, I'm crazy, no one else, I don't even know who I'm looking for. So I couldn't find anything in the New York Public Library because Steve had spelled his name wrong, and it's A-Y-R-E-S. And also, I wasn't feeling very confident. So they sent me down to the main New York Public Library, and they couldn't find anything on the internet, and they said to me, why don't you try the New York Academy of Medicine Library up on 5th and 103rd Street? So the New York, I don't know if you've been to New York.
Public Library is on 42nd
and 5th. And the New York, so that's like a 60 block bus ride. And it was August 5th, and I wanted to go swimming. And but this is the third library, and so he scribbled down the address, like, I don't want to do this. I this is stupid. I mean, all those negative things. This is dumb, nobody cares. Steve probably doesn't even remember I said I was gonna look for him. And I think it was just a pig-headedness, so like, well, I got to see this through to the bitter end. And so, it was a bus with no air conditioning, and about halfway up Madison Avenue on 70th Street, suddenly this sort of clear voice came up in me, and I thought, I'm going to find this guy. I don't know what happened to him, but I'm not leaving this library until I find him. And again, it's very hard when you've been a victim yourself, and you realize it's if you do find this guy, it's probably going to be a big deal. So went to me at this library, which was very, it was like a mansion, and no one else was in there, and the librarian wasn't very friendly, and we couldn't find anything either because the name was spelled wrong. There was nothing that his name was published in PubMed. She went out to lunch, and I want to say, have you ever tried to look for something, but you're afraid to look for it? And you know, you won't find it if you're afraid to look for it. And there were these, I've looked for doctors as a journalist. I know the first place you go is it's called the ABMS Board Directory of Medical Specialists. They're big red, they're about this big, they're fire engine red, and I didn't look there. I thought that Ayres wasn't in San Mateo, and then suddenly I looked at these books, and I thought, why not make it simple and just go look and see if he's still in California and San Mateo? So I felt like I walked over to these books in a trance. It's almost like someone had set this path up for me. I pulled it down, looked up San Mateo, and there he is. And Steve had remembered that he was on North San Mateo Drive. Like, ooh. And, you know, that changed everything. So the librarian, I told her, and now we had the correct spelling of his name.